good morning, friends and colleagues. We think we should start. We're already almost 10 minutes behind schedule. So first of all, let me welcome you all to this round table. Apologies, we couldn't make the table round, but hopefully the conversation would be quite interactive nonetheless. I also would like to thank you for your decision to join this meeting rather than one of the other very interesting options that are available on the IGF program. My name is Edet Ojo. I'm director of Media Rights Agenda, which is a free expression organization based in Lagos, Nigeria. I will be your moderator for this roundtable. Just to provide some background, the African Declaration on Internet Rights and Freedoms was developed by a coalition of African civil society organizations as a way to guide the creation of a positive rights-based and democratically governed internet policy environment in Africa. And it's been developed in the context of the African continent, where access to the internet is growing very rapidly. We now have a lot of citizens, millions of citizens in different countries across the continent, getting online, finding their voices on social media platforms, as well as various other online and digital tools. And in those discussions and debates, they are venturing into areas that previously you didn't find ordinary folks talking about. Issues of governance, of democratic performance of political leaders, and so on. And this is creating a very scary environment for political leaders across the continent. And that has triggered an anxiety to try and regulate the online environment and space. So as political leaders and authorities are moving to regulate the online environment, the declaration that has been developed, which we'll be talking around today, seeks to promote a human rights, a set of human rights standards and principles of openness in internet policy. And these have been formulated, and we hope that they would be implemented in a way that would open up the online space. They're also intended to elaborate on principles that are necessary to uphold human rights and people's rights on the internet. A lot of these issues and other relevant issues would be discussed by the very distinguished speakers we have on the roundtable, and I would proceed to introduce them very shortly. But before I do that, let me quickly explain the format for this discussion. As I said, we want to have a very interactive conversation. We do not want lectures. We do not want long speeches and presentations. We have a total of 7 speakers. 2 of them are not yet in the room, but I think that they will be joining us later on. I would explain subsequently. Each speaker would have an initial opportunity to make some remarks on a relevant topic or theme for about 5 minutes, which should take us a total of 35 minutes. I hope my mathematics still works, but I think that should be about 35 minutes, and I think this should leave us with ample time to have a real conversation. Following the initial remarks by the speakers, we'll then invite participants to present their own views or raise questions, either directly on the declaration itself or on the broader questions and issues that are relevant. Copies of the declaration are on the table, I think. Those who have not had a chance previously to read them should be able to quickly scan through them, but you would get more information as we proceed. We know that there's a great deal of knowledge and expertise in the room outside of the designated speakers, so we are also looking for a way to draw on these experiences. So we would be requesting the speakers, whenever they wish, to also pose questions to participants as a way of tapping into that knowledge and expertise that it's on the other side of the room, so that it's not a one-way flow of information. So please feel free to post questions and raise issues that participants can also feed into. Now, to quickly introduce the speakers, the gentleman to my right, I think there's only one gentleman to my right, yes. It's Mr. McCann Fire. He is currently the Chief of Knowledge Services Section at the United Nations Economic Commission for Africa, which is based in Addis Ababa, Ethiopia. In this capacity, he spearheads the promotion of information and knowledge societies in general, and in particular, content and information systems development, knowledge management, and the development of knowledge networks and communities of practice, as well as promoting e-tools for access to knowledge in Africa. He has over 34 years of experience in ICT for development and information management, with 25 of these years spent at the UN Economic Commission for Africa. He's also the president of the Federation of United Nations Staff Unions and Associations. So as you can see, he's a big man, as you say in Nigeria. Then to my extreme left is Nena Wankama. She comes from the internet, as she likes to say, but in the real world, she's the Africa Regional Coordinator for the World Wide Web Foundation. She works to develop cutting-edge collaborations in Africa and has a particular focus on the Alliance for Affordable Internet, as well as the Web We Want campaign, which some of you may be familiar with, if not all of you. And she's also heavily involved in driving the open data agenda across Africa. In recent years, she's co-founded the Free Software and Open Source Foundation for Africa and served on a board, as a board member of the Open Source Initiative. She's been involved in many phases of the UN's Africa Information Society Initiative. She has lived and worked in 5 African countries. She's almost a nomad and is fluent in English, French, and a number of African languages. To my immediate left is Gbenga Sheson. In a Nigerian context, and I believe globally, he's a renowned ICT expert. He's the executive director of Paradigm Initiative Nigeria. He has implemented projects on behalf of numerous institutions, including Microsoft, where he's made a lot of money, Harvard University, the UN Economic Commission for Africa, the ITU, amongst others. He's an Archbishop Tutu Leadership Fellow. He's a member of the United Nations Committee of E-Leaders on Youth and ICT, and was Nigeria's first Information Technology Youth Ambassador. In 2006, he was appointed as the youngest member of the Nigerian Presidential Task Force on the restructuring of the Nigerian information technology and telecommunications sector. He serves on the boards of numerous national, regional, and international organizations in the ICT and other sectors. To my immediate right is Lilian Nawoga, who is president of the Internet Society Uganda chapter and works with the Collaboration on International ICT Policy in East and Southern Africa, SPESA, as a policy associate. She's contributed to ICT policy reviews in Uganda and East Africa, undertaking research, facilitated and coordinated ICT policy workshops, including coordinating the East African Internet Governance Forum and the Uganda Internet Governance Forum. She has hands-on experience in information technology and projects management. She's interested in linking communications technologies to improving rural lives. And I hope she will start with mine so that I can be lifted out of poverty. Unfortunately, we don't yet have Ephraim Kayanito. He sent me a message this morning to say he wasn't feeling very well. He just walked into the room, so at least he's still walking. Thank you, Ephraim, for trying to make it nonetheless. He's a policy analyst at accessnow.org, working on the connection between internet policy and human rights. He's also a member of the UN Secretary General's 2015 Multi-Stakeholder Advisory Group on Internet Governance, the Freedom Online Coalition's Digital Development and Openness Working Group, and currently serves as a member of the Interim Steering Committee for the Youth Coalition on Internet Governance. IFRIM has worked on democratic governance, human rights, transparency, international development, and youth engagement. We have, to my extreme right, I will refrain from using some of the appellations that I've heard recently. Emila Vuche, she leads the policy work in Africa for the Association for Progressive Communications, APC, not the political party in Nigeria. This is an NGO based in South Africa. She's devoted to ICT policy development and has over the years been engaged in expanding it from a multi-stakeholder approach at national and regional levels in Africa. Her most recent work includes management and engagement in the West African Internet Governance Forum in 2010, the first Southern Africa Internet Governance Forum in 2011, the African Schools on Internet Governance, the launch of the first African Internet Governance Forum in 2012, and then the initiative on the African Declaration on Internet Rights and Freedoms. In 2012, Emila was appointed by the Internet Society an Internet Governance Forum ambassador. So you should call her Her Excellency when you address her. She continues to advocate for innovative approaches to spectrum use and management as a means of extending affordable access and securing and defending fundamental human rights on the internet. Our final speaker, who unfortunately is at another session because he is a speaker on two sessions that are going on simultaneously, is David Kay, who many of you may know. He's a clinical professor of law at the University of California in the United States and is currently the United Nations Special Rapporteur on the Promotion and Protection of the Right of Freedom of Opinion and Expression. We've had a tough negotiation and agreed that he will spend the first 45 minutes in the other session, and at about 9:45, he will join us. So we'll keep our fingers crossed. So having done the fairly lengthy introductions, I would now invite McCann to please open the discussion. Please, let's try and keep to the 5 minutes. We're going to be counting down, and I will try to be very brutal in my moderation. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Just to start, I will just put a bit of emphasis on why do we need an African Declaration on Internet Rights and Freedoms. The right to freedom of opinion and expression is guaranteed under several instruments at the international and African levels, such as Article 19 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, the Convention for the Protection of Human Rights and Fundamental Freedoms, Article 10, and the African Charter on Human and People's Rights, Article 9, and the African Union Convention on Cybersecurity and Personal Data Protection, Articles 8, 17, and 25. However, the rapid and monumental changes to ICTs experienced since the beginning of the WSIS process have influenced privacy issues with heavy impact on human rights, including in Africa. In this context, there is a need for increased interaction between government entities and all other interested stakeholders in ongoing and future deliberations on enhancing trust and privacy in cyberspace, in order to secure the right to freedom of expression, the right of access to information and knowledge without fear, without restrictions and limitations, the right of freedom of assembly, the right to freedom of opinion, and the right to be free from discrimination in all forms. We believe that a tool which would affect take care of this on the continent did not exist. So that's why we think that it is time to put in place a declaration on internet rights and freedoms. And in this context, the African IGF panel, which was organized on 7 September 2015 in Addis Ababa, where we had a subject on human rights on the internet, had also discussed thoroughly the African Declaration on Internet Rights and Freedoms. And the conclusions of the panel was that access to the internet is essential for the full realization of human development and facilitates the exercise and enjoyment of a number of human rights and freedoms, including the rights to freedom of expression and access to information and knowledge, peaceful assembly and association. Access and affordability should be priority for all states as part of human development and human rights. Access and affordability should be also priority when talking of human rights on the internet. So that's why we believe that this declaration is timely and that we will talk about its content later. Thank you, Mr. Moderator.
Thank you very much for your initial comments and for keeping to time. I would encourage others to follow your footsteps. May I now invite Nena from the internet to share her perspectives.
Hello, and good morning. I would like to speak to two things, why I believe that the declaration is key. At the Web Foundation, we do three things. We do what we call access, the other voice, and the other is participation. And many people may think that we're a technology organization, but no, we are not a technology organization. We are a development organization, and we work in these three ways. Advocating for access. We believe that access to the internet should be a human right. I'll take that again. We believe that access to broadband internet should be a human right. And we believe that the internet itself should be a common, should be a global good, should be as protected as the air and water. And that is where we come in with what we call voices. You must have heard about Web We Want. Web We Want, in a very simple manner, is this. The rights that people have offline should be applied to them online. So all of our human rights offline should be the same online. In participation in the work we do at the Web Foundation, we ask governments, we ask entities, we ask stakeholders to put out data and to empower participation. This year, we are looking at sustainable development and the role that internet governance and internet as a whole should be playing on this. And it is important for us to note that when we adopted the MDGs, we did not have smartphones. We could not click on share, and our capacity to upload and download was very limited. But now we have the internet, and SDGs powered by the internet has a greater potential to be achieved. And that is where, Mr. Chair, this declaration takes its meaning for us. As civil society organization, this is a tool to go home and say, if we want to achieve goal this, goal that, goal this. I take, for instance, the goal on women empowerment. And the UN has said we want everyone to have access to the internet by 2020, especially women. But I want to say that if we want everyone to have access to the internet by 2020, it means that we need to begin to re-look the principles in country. And these are the principles you have in this book. We need to begin to have a change in the way we think about access to the internet. We need to have a change in the way we think about affordability and the cost of internet access. We need to begin to have a change in policy in the way we look at freedom of information and freedom of expression. So these are the principles that this declaration brings to fore. And I believe that as civil society, we need this to go home with at national level to input in our strategy for the realization of the SDGs. Once again, my name is Nena. I come from the internet, and I believe if you are not yet there, you will soon join me. So it's a life and death issue. If you've not migrated yet, you are on your way. If you are following on remote, then you are already there. If you are tweeting about it, Internet is your life. In fact, if you came here on an electronic ticket, it means you are already in the kingdom of internet people. So it's all about our lives. And these brothers and sisters, as I call you, my fellow citizens of the internet, this will be part of the constitution of our own country. See you online.
Thank you very much, Nena, for making that very practical for us to understand, especially those of us who are a bit simpler. Gbenga, I believe you're also from the internet.
So Nena says this is a matter of life and death, and I have bad news. So as I speak to you, the National Assembly in Nigeria tweeted, and this is the irony, right? So the National Assembly in Nigeria has a Twitter handle, NAS Nigeria, and they tweeted these words, and I quote, let me just paraphrase. House of Assembly calls for social media censorship. That's tweeted by the handle of the National Assembly itself. So when we say that this this is an issue that isn't just in terms of writing declarations, that it's a serious issue, we're not saying that because we just want to write and make some words popular. A lot of people have been invited, some by the Secret Service, some arrested, in the name of the things they've tweeted. As I speak to you, there are two bloggers in Nigeria who have been victims, of course, of Section 24 of the new cybercrime law because they wrote an opinion that powerful people who have access to police found offensive. Now, in a case of libel, you're supposed to prove that someone has said something that hurt you, right? But these guys don't even wait to prove anything. They simply use the security forces they have access to arrest anyone that says anything they're not interested in. I think that we've gone past the stage where, you know, we think that we're discussing internet rights in Africa because it's cool to do so. We're discussing these things because it's a matter of life and death. Because there are people who have left home and who have not returned. I can tell you the story of a young man called, let me call him Siakson, what his Twitter handle is. This young man tweeted what he saw in Abuja in Nigeria. He saw militants or terrorists, Boko Haram terrorists, fighting with security officers, and he posted a picture and he praised the security officers and said, oh, these guys are doing a great job, and he disappeared. 21 days, he wasn't found, until there was pressure on the security agencies because everyone denied they had him. And what they were doing was they were passing him, and they were right. When we asked the Secret Service, is he with you? They said no. You know why they were right? Because they had moved him to another security agency. And when you move to the next security agency to ask for him, is he with you? They would say no, because they had passed him on to the next security agency because he posted a tweet. Unfortunately, governments want to be in charge and they want to control things. It's natural, right, for governments. And one of the problems we have right now is that governments are beginning to realize that the internet is a space for expression. I mean, just yesterday we saw, what happened at the open ceremony, right? Where people were trying to freely express themselves and security officers told them to shut up and took their stuff away. That's what governments will do. Because every government wants to be in charge, no government wants to be surprised. And unfortunately, in not being surprised, many governments are going beyond their call of duty. Many governments are going beyond the fundamental rights that they have to, step on the rights of citizens. And that is why the various sections in this declaration speak to many things. One of that is data privacy. As I speak to you right now in Nigeria, there are 7 agencies of government that hold your biometric data. Note, Nigeria does not have data privacy laws. Next year, during the census, the Population Commission also wants to collect biometric data. That makes 8. Your telecom registration, your international passport, your driver's license, and of course, your bank. My bank account has now been suspended. I don't have access. Of course, they don't mind receiving money into my account, so you are free to transfer money to me, but I can't get money out because I've refused to give my biometric data. And I will not, for obvious reasons, because when you don't assure me of protection, then I know that someone one day would likely plant you, because if you don't like me as government and you think I'm a threat to you, I'll probably one day be accused of terrorism and my fingerprint will be proved to be on the site because somebody will exceed authority and plant it there. Data theft is real. When we have these conversations about internet rights, we're not discussing fancy words like data privacy, like open internet, like zero rating and things like that. We're discussing the matters of existence or annihilation. Thank you.
Okay, Gbenga, thank you for scaring us a little bit. I hope I am hoping that East Africa is better. So I would ask Lillian to let us know what's happening in her region of Africa. Lillian, you have the floor.
Thank you so much. These things always scare me because I know someone is listening out there apart from me. And then, Benga has already put some fears around. Yes, thank you so much. Just to add on what Benga and Nina have said, for me, I would like to just share that indeed, in Africa, there are initiatives that are trying to promote internet rights, and one of those is the Open Net Africa Initiative, which is an initiative that was started by CIPESA in 2012, and we are trying to find ways in which we can advocate or promote internet freedoms in the region through research and advocacy, providing trainings and engagement with stakeholders. For some of the, I know, faces here who know about the internet freedom project in East Africa, and a month back, the mic is just in my face. Okay. Yes, the OpenNet Initiative does research and advocacy around internet freedom concerns in the region, and some of these is the data protection. Just like Benga said, in many African countries, I stand to be corrected, we do not have data protection laws, and we have so many laws or so many policy frameworks that make it a point to take our data. Unfortunately, the bank has all my details, but man, I need to access my account. I don't know how you survive without money. But that aside, I think what makes this Africa Declaration, this framework that we are all here today to hear about, is that this it takes processes. What we are trying to do is we're trying to do research just in a few selected countries in Africa, and I think this can be one of the mechanisms that we can use to further our research. What we've learned is there are scattered initiatives, and when I say scattered, I know Paradigm Initiative is doing something, the Web We Want, APC, and CIPESA, and maybe Kictanet in Kenya, and ATCO 19. But this is just a handful of civil society organizations that are trying to promote this. As Benga and Nina said, governments, they don't, maybe they care, but their own thing is, you know, cybersecurity, which is broad and vague in how they, you know, they state it, national terrorism. So we've learned that, one, we need processes. We need to empower citizens to be able to advocate. Today we are here, we're not just going to say, okay, yeah, we are launching the Africa Declaration on Internet Rights, but how do we get to the ordinary citizen to be able to understand what it is we are saying here? And I think for those who are coming from Africa, this is one of the steps that we can take. Simple, small steps, empower people to understand the importance of the internet as a tool for empowerment, not as just as a tool to go to Facebook or WhatsApp or just tweet about anything that excites you, but they need to understand what are the underlying issues around use of the internet, data protection alone, freedom of expression, access to content, and also once they realize that, then they'll start demanding for broadband. They'll start demanding for reducing of costs. So the most important thing is to empower citizens to be able to understand that the internet is a tool for development. Then they'll start realizing why we need to promote internet freedoms or internet rights on the internet.
Thank you very much, Lillian. Ephraim, do you feel up to it? Okay, thank you. Please, you have the floor.
Okay, hi, my name is Ephraim Kenyanito, and I'm glad to be here. I'm going to talk about the correlation between what our governments say nationally and what they commit themselves to international, what they commit themselves internationally and what they do in the, at the domestic level, the kind of hypocrisy that happens and what we can do to hold them to account. For example, on 21st of October, the Interparliamentary Union, it is, has a membership of 167 parliaments, and almost all of the African governments are part of this, the African parliaments, committed to a resolution on digital development and democracy in the digital era, which was a great commitment, and I hope we hold them to account. The hypocrisy of this is, okay, before we get to the hypocrisy, during the UPR of the Universal Periodic Review, which is something, a mechanism under the Human Rights Council to hold governments to account for their human rights commitment, during the UPR of the USA, the Kenyan government pointed out the kind of surveillance that the U.S. is doing and all that. But then, and in addition to that, the co-sponsors for the Special Rapporteur on Privacy are from Africa. These were the countries, Angola, Djibouti, Uganda, Zambia. They called for the Special Rapporteur, which is a really good thing. But then, how many of these countries have data protection regimes? How many of these countries lack data protection regimes? In Africa, these are the only countries that have data protection, Angola, Benin, Botswana, very few countries. And you look at the surveillance technology, Finn Fisher and Hacking Team. How many of our countries in Africa have been implicated in these revelations of this Hacking Team and Finn Fisher? Ethiopia, Egypt, South Africa, Nigeria, Angola, Kenya, Gabon, Morocco, Uganda, Egypt, Nigeria. So many countries, and what are we doing to hold them to account? What they commit internationally vis-a-vis what they do nationally? So we need to find a way, like for them, when they sign, they commit themselves to these initiatives. This is the thing that Africa, and I'm going to give a case for my own country, and I'm sure there's some people here from Kenya who know the situation. We signed up to the ICC, the International Criminal Court, the Rome Statute, and as Africa, we sign on to so many documents, so many declarations, but then when it comes to implementation at the domestic level, we don't do it. And this is a weakness which we can use as a strategy for civil society. For example, this recent IPU, Interparliamentary Union declaration, we can use them to hold them to account using the things they do at an international level. And I was looking at the UPR mechanism, the Universal Periodic Review mechanisms, and last week, which is still ongoing, it's ending on 13th of this month, they're doing review of a bunch of countries, and Mauritania and Rwanda are part of the review for this past week. How many of us hold our governments to account at that level? Because there you can participate as a civil society organization, you don't need so much input. Like you can do a joint submission with UN accredited organizations or something. We need to work together to hold our governments to account. That's what I just wanted to insist. And this declaration is timely, and it shouldn't go just to be another document that we say it was passed. We need to use it. We need to translate it as Lillian talked about, as Nena also talked about. We need to translate it to the local level, whereby people are able to understand what their rights are. That's the basics of the rule of law, whereby you're able to know this is this law, this is the procedure, this due process that's going to be followed for this law to be for it to be held into account on the basis of this law. So I'll be happy to talk more about this. Thank you.
Thank you, Ephraim. Perhaps I should mention here that one of our objectives in the development of this declaration is to provide some guidance for governments that are embarking on policy and lawmaking processes. The assumption here is that maybe they don't really know the right thing or they don't know how to go about it. There's not a lot of expertise, legal or technical, around these issues. So this would provide some guidance for them when they're making laws and policies. But I think there is also a duty on other stakeholders, particularly civil society, to do the advocacy that is necessary to bring the text of the declaration to the attention of governments, and to engage those law and policy-making processes to ensure that these principles find their way into those documents. So in terms of moving forward, that's an area we're going to be talking about a lot. How can we use these principles and standards that are outlined in this document to improve the legal frameworks and the legal environments under which we're operating in the different countries. Our final speaker for now would be Emile Avouche, who is from Southern Africa, which I expect is the leader in the region, right?
Yes, Southern Africa is not just a leader in the in Africa, but also women are leaders in Africa. Okay, so I'll talk about the challenges, the key human rights issues or challenges that we need policy interventions on in Africa. Some of them have been raised already, and we have so many, but I would like to only highlight three challenges. The first one is that at national level, courts and legislatures have continued to grapple with complex policy matters that impact human rights. We've seen that in so many African countries and probably in your continents as well, there are new legal measures to curb internet freedom, and there are problematic laws or regulations that are enacted, and mostly they, we are told that they are there to protect the vulnerable, the women, the children, but these laws or regulations usually have provisions that are not clear or provisions that are vague. And ambiguous language that could be abused. And usually these regulations, for example, one country I'll not mention has introduced new online regulations to protect children, to develop the ICT environment in the country. But in actual effect, it has very broad restrictions in terms of freedom of expression. The second issue that I would also like to highlight is that there is a harsh environment for women and members of the LGBTI community who are both underrepresented online and disproportionately harassed for their online activities. For example, Take Back the Tech, an initiative run by APC, has faced a huge amount of intimidation and threats and attacks. And it's run by women, and this is something that we are also seeing. The third aspect that I would also want to raise is access. And Nena has talked about access already. But I think access is still an issue, because access to information, as we all know, is very important if we are to realize our human rights. And in Africa, I would say, and in many other parts of the developing world, it's either we are access poor, we are access denied, or access oppressed. In many countries in Africa, there's less than 5% of the people who are online. And in some areas, less than 2% who are online. So there is still a very big, a large population which is not online. And they are also, we're also access denied. We've realized that in many African countries, the government has shut down the internet when it suits them, especially when there are service delivery protests or during elections. So you might have access, but it's denied to you. And then we are also access oppressed. We are here in an air-conditioned room eating very nice Brazilian food, but think of the human rights defenders who are out there who are oppressed because of the work that they are doing on the internet or using the internet. Think Allah Abdel Fattah, who is languishing in jail right now because of the work that he does using the internet. so many journalists, so many bloggers, so many human rights defenders face jail terms, they face imprisonment, just because they use the internet, just because they want to disseminate information. So it's either we are access poor, access denied, or access oppressed. And as APC, we encourage a rights-based approach to access where people are involved in the ICT policy development decision processes to ensure that we meet real and expressed needs. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Amila. And I have to thank all the speakers who have kept religiously to time. I don't know whether it's the fear of the brutality that I threatened in the beginning that has worked so well. We're expecting David Kay to join us any moment now, but meanwhile, I would like to open it up for a conversation. Whenever David comes, we'll give him an opportunity to share his own ideas. But for now, I would like to hear from the other side of the room, questions, comments, points of view. Please indicate if you would like to intervene, and then you use one of these two microphones up front because you are being watched, you are being filmed, and we want you facing the camera when you ask your question so that you can be captured appropriately. I hope that is not intimidating for anyone. That was not the intention. Some people like to be on camera, actually, so I thought that that might be an incentive. So, Henriette, I would very much like to hear from you, because as we said, there's a lot of expertise on the other side of the room, and I think you are somebody who would have a lot of important knowledge to share. So if you don't mind. Yes, please. Questions? Okay.
This is very intimidating. Well, thank you to the panel. It's really wonderful to see that we launched the declaration a year ago, and since then we've actually been using it. So, but I want to ask you. Yesterday in a panel that I was in, Nanjira, I don't know if she's here, from Kenya, talked about how hard it is to demand rights in Africa because so many people haven't experienced rights. And it's if you have had rights and then they are taken away from you, it's easier to react and have an articulate demand for those rights to be reinstated. When you've never experienced rights, how do you mobilize people? How do you build an organized, systematic advocacy campaign? Or do you just take it issue by issue, as Benga was saying? You know, something happened and you try and do it. So just maybe your responses to that. And then I think also, I want to ask you about language, because one of the issues we've struggled with, I've been part of the African Declaration Group, is language. And what language we use when we ask for rights. Do we use the language of legal instruments, of international human rights law, which is what we want, but it's a language that is hard for us to use at two levels. Firstly, because our states disregard those standards 100% in most cases. Even in a country like South Africa, it's increasingly hard to use human rights language as a discourse with those in authority. And it's also a language that's hard to use when you're trying to get people excited about this this issue. So, and how do we find a balance between having correct language that is not going to weaken rights, but that is also a language that can be the basis for a strong, productive dialogue?
Thank you. I would just suggest that anybody who has a response, keep it for now. We'll take a bunch of interventions and then we'll have a conversation. Gabriel, you have to come up front, please.
Thank you. Hi, Gabrielle, Article 19. We were also involved in the drafting of the African Declaration. Just wanted to make a quick remark in response to Anne-Marie's comment. And I think that it really depends on which instrument we're talking about. I don't think it's mutually exclusive. I think we can have an African Declaration that reflects strong demands and international standards, but that should not prevent other campaigns being run with a language that's less legalistic, because the African Declaration, insofar as it reflects standards and is calling for the adoption of certain laws, for instance, then it can be used for that and have like slightly more legal language, in my view. However, insofar as a campaign is concerned, I think, you know, it can be, you know, you can use it to make it sound more exciting and glamorous. I just wanted to add that. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. First time I'm hearing that legal language can be exciting and glamorous, but anything is possible. Yolanda? I tend to favor women, so you're going to see that reflected in the people I recognize. I'm upfront about it.
Hello, everyone. So I have a question regarding the content of the declaration. There's a section which talks about internet access and affordability, but within that section, there's also universal and equal access. So I want to know, how do we balance affordable access versus universal access? Because universal access to me seems as if something that's free that everyone can access without a cost, but then affordability has a cost in it. So I'm not quite sure what is meant by internet access and affordability and it being universal, because what's affordable to me may not be affordable to you. So thank you.
Thank you. I would come back to you on that. That's what she lives on. Who else? Tule, please.
Let me start by thanking all the members of the panel here for speaking so well and for updating us with all the details that they gave. A suggestion I want to offer here is that we need to reckon with the schools as a very good base for mobilization, because most of the people who use the internet in Africa, and I want to believe that this is the same, this is also true of other parts of the world, are young people. If we try to integrate our mobilization into the school system, we're really going to achieve a lot within a very short time. Secondly, we also need to take advantage of the dynamism of the multidimensionality of journalism communication programs in our schools. So we don't necessarily have to formally seek endorsement for the content of this declaration to get them integrated into our curricula. There are courses like media and society, information science, you know, and such others, whose teachers could be lobbied to integrate the contents of this into their teaching materials, and that way we can get this popularized, even general studies in the universities and polytechnics. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Tunde. We'll start by lobbying you. You didn't introduce yourself, but obviously, Tunde is a journalism teacher at one of the universities in Nigeria, so hopefully he's lobbied. Our remote moderator, would you let us know if there are remote participants who have comments or questions? Yeah? I saw a handout. I'm not sure whether it's the remote moderator, sir.
You can hear me.
Okay.
Now you can hear me. Hi.
Okay.
We have one comment from Avi Momeni in Cameroon. He wants to put forward that the civil society in Cameroon is very strongly approving of the African Declaration, and he's putting forward the proposal to consider the African Declaration as a handbook for each African internet user. They themselves and their organization have been working with secondary schools on the principle to make them more approachable for students. And he's also asking a concrete question on the follow-up on this presentation for the African Declaration and what is the best way forward for strategizing going forward. He wants to know how can we approach ICT governments, regulatory and control bodies to endorse the document in the future. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. The speakers would get back on that. I saw a couple of hands up. Sorry, the lady here and the gentleman behind would come immediately after her.
Hi, my name is Sylvia. I'm from Hevosys Africa. And my question is on creating public awareness or user awareness on privacy, especially when it's seen that it's the responsibility of government to give security to users online, and you find the users are the ones who celebrate government surveillance. So how do we create user awareness on privacy so that they can also join in the fight for internet freedom online?
Thank you. Yes.
Thank you very much. My name is Demba. I come from The Gambia. I'm a journalist and freedom on the internet researcher for Freedom House. I have a couple of questions and a comment, and I'll start with the comment. My comment is I've read the declaration on freedom on the internet and on Africa, and I like it. I like the content. It's very beautiful. My concern is in Africa, we have a lot of human rights instruments, the African Commission or the African Charter on Human and People Rights. It's collecting dust, and a lot of other instruments are collecting dust in a lot of African governments' cupboards, you know. So I'm just worried that this could be just another document for dust collection in another African country, probably, especially in The Gambia. First question is, for instance, somebody mentioned in the panel, I can't remember exactly who, that rights offline should be reflected online. This is, for me, is probably not a perfect approach in every country. For instance, in The Gambia, we don't have public space in the offline. So if you think of extending or equating rights offline to the online space, it's probably not applicable. I mean, in as much as it's a problem in Gambia, probably it's not a problem in the US or in other parts of Africa, actually. But I think we need to think about that and think of how probably we could, you know, factor in situations like The Gambia and other less free countries on the continent. I think I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you. I'd like you to go away with some hope that, you know, it's better that the documents are in the cupboard. They could be in the dustbin. The fact that they're in the cupboard means that there's some intention or some plan someday to look at them. But if they were in the dustbin, you know, that's the end of the matter. So let's take a positive attitude. We've now been joined by David Kay. I explained earlier why he wasn't able to be with us from the beginning. So we have him here, and we're honored and privileged that he was willing to share himself and be in two places at the same time. He's managed to pull it off. Thank you very much. So I'd now like to give the floor to David to share his views with us.
Thank you. Thank you, Edit. I actually was able to be in two places at one time because I followed what was happening on Twitter. Well, so for those of you tweeting, thank you. So I haven't obviously been able to follow as closely, so I don't, you know, want to repeat anything that's already been said, but I did want to say a couple of things. So one is, I think efforts like the African Declaration are critical. And they're critical because moving, I mean, I think this is a general trend in human rights law, that real enforcement and normative development or translation of the international norms has to happen at regional, national, and even local levels. And if you don't have, you know, this translation, essentially, of the international down to the local, then, you know, we really do lose the ability to educate ourselves and to enforce these norms. And I also think that it goes both directions, right? The norms that are framed and are developed at the grassroots, you know, up to the regional and then the international level, that's an important transmission belt also. It's not just from the international to the national. So these kinds of efforts, I think, are really important. The second thing is, in relation to the last question about the collecting dust, I mean, anybody who writes anything has that fear. Although I don't know what digital dust is, but you have a hard copy here. I mean, I actually think that that these principles will be used, and actually this comes at a moment when regional courts and sub-regional courts in Africa are starting to develop a kind of jurisprudence and practice. So, you know, much as it's easy to look at other systems like Inter-American and European and say they're so developed and they have decades of jurisprudence, but that I think is beginning in the African system, to the extent we can call it a system, in the East African Court of Justice, in the ECOWAS Court. I mean, there may be opportunities, and so I guess one thing I would encourage people to do is to use the principles in the declaration first to litigate. I think, you know, impact, even just impact litigation can be really important, but to take the principles here and actually use them in your regional litigation efforts. So for those of you who are actually active in pursuing rights, whether digital or otherwise, in Africa, I think that that's one possibility. And there are also actors both inside and outside of Africa who are working on these kinds of issues at the level of litigation. So, I mean, I would really encourage people not to allow this document to gather dust, but to actually start to use it to identify which of the principles apply in particular cases that you're pursuing. And even if you're pursuing cases or you're pursuing, maybe it's Geneva focused, looking at resolutions or whatnot, to highlight that what's happening in one place is happening in other places as well. And so I congratulate you, Edit, on pulling this all together, but I do think that it should have value moving forward and that people should actually put it into use.
Thanks very much. Excuse me. Thanks very much for your comments, David. I think they're very encouraging, not just because of the wisdom behind them, but also because of the person saying them. So very much appreciated. Now, are there any, and I think we should take the opportunity of David being here to also raise a number of these questions relating to freedom of expression and opinion. I mean, he's the UN expert on these issues and can provide a lot of guidance for those of us who need his expertise. So any other questions or issues that we want to raise? And I particularly would love to hear from some non-Africans. It's a conversation that is going on within the African continent, but we don't know whether in that bubble that we're just talking to ourselves and really not making sense. So I don't know what the non-Africans think and would love to hear from them. Yes? Are non-Africans shy? Okay. Like David, I don't know what digital shyness looks like. Okay, what happened to Andrew? He stepped out. Okay, so I think I would now ask our speakers to respond to some of the issues that have been raised. And then also, if they have specific questions, they think that some of the participants would be able to either share experiences from their countries or regions or share their individual expertise, they can also put those questions to participants. Yeah. So then I'll start with you on the issue of access and affordability, universal access and affordability, which Yolanda was suggesting amounts to some sort of contradiction.
Okay. Let me give you that same sentence I keep sharing. All of the people, all of the internet, all of the time. This means that everybody should be free and able to access the internet. That is what universality means. People being free and able to access the internet. Affordability is about the pricing and the cost of it. I would like to draw our attention, Mr. Chair, that the Italian Bill of Rights was sponsored by the Italian Chamber of Deputies, which is the equivalent of your National Assembly in Nigeria. So it is the lawmakers themselves that saw the need to grant these rights to their citizens. And I would like to read the Article 2 of the Italian Bill of Rights. The Article 2 is on right to internet access. Point 1 in Article 2 says, access to the internet is a fundamental right of all persons and a condition for their individual and social development. This has been ratified in Italy. So every Italian citizen has a right to internet access. That means that under no condition should you deny access to the internet to an Italian citizen. Countries like Estonia and Finland has even gone ahead and said not just anyhow internet access, but actually broadband internet access. I want to add that the Broadband Commission has said that internet access, affordable internet access, has been defined as not more than 5% of your average monthly income in a country. So what is the average monthly salary in a country? What is 5% of that average monthly income? If your broadband internet access costs more than that, then it's expensive. I have a pain in my heart because I would rather not speak about Gambia. Gambia is a country that we had bought tickets to go to Gambia to begin work as the Alliance for Affordable Internet. Not everything can be said online. Not everything can be said here in Brazil. I wish I could go to Gambia and say some of the things I want to say, Mr. Chair. But for the love of Africa, I wouldn't say those things. But let me say the one that is okay here in Brazil. It is to say that the internet is not necessarily a new reality in terms of rights. So you find that, I have tweeted that our online activities reflect our offline realities. So if you see that voice over IP cannot happen in Gambia, it is because offline too, even voice over expression may not be happening, okay? You understand what I mean? I will stop here.
Okay, on that issue as well, on the issue of access and affordability, Ephraim and McCann also have some comments, so I'll give them the floor. Ephraim, go first.
Okay, on the issue of universality, I just wanted to emphasize, all of the internet, all of the time. We've seen incidences in Africa where there's correlation between internet shutdowns and state violence or state violations for human rights. For example, Burundi, Congo last week, was it last week or last week, part one, Congo Brazzaville, whereby people are organizing, let's say, demonstrations, peaceful demonstrations. They have gotten the legal process of having those demonstrations, but then the government, not to disrupt those demonstrations, shuts down the internet. They order telcos to shut down the internet. Same thing happened to Burundi. Same thing we saw in DRC at the beginning of the year. And in Burundi, I would just love to go to Burundi because, as you can see, I'm also wearing an East African community T-shirt. It's a community for East Africa, for the five countries. They're trying to come up with a union. And the case for Burundi is very disheartening. I feel it because I have partners, friends there. And activists, journalists were being physically tortured to give passwords to their devices so that their photos could be deleted while they were leaving through to go to Rwanda. Such kind of incidences, they have, it doesn't go into the kind of coverage that we desire on this, but then all of the internet, all of the time, like these kind of actions by the government whereby they shut down telecommunications equipment, we need to find a strategy around this. And also on that matter, I would just like to highlight that last year in June, the African governments met in Gambia, the Equatorial Guinea, in the Equatorial Guinea, I don't know why I'm thinking about Gambia, the Equatorial Guinea, and they passed the African Convention on Cybersecurity. But then this process has been marred with lack of transparency. Some laws are being put into other laws, for example, laws on counterterrorism. There's some clauses being sneaked in some jurisdictions which impact digital rights. There's, for example, let me use an example. I don't know how many Zimbabweans are in the room. Is there any Zimbabwean? Okay, yes. For example, Zimbabwe, they've been discussing how they're going to implement that, and then they've come up with a bill. Some of these laws are not accessible online. I had to have some friends in Zimbabwe to leak that, not Emila, but someone else, some friends to leak to me those laws. They're not accessible even to the common people. I just wanted to analyze and see the implications for digital rights. And we find there's need to highlight to ensure more transparency on this. Like, how can we ensure our governments legislate this in a multi-stakeholder, more transparent? Because you see, in most African, I know my time is almost up. In most African countries, the governments put this cybersecurity as more a military tool, military intervention. It's the government that ought to ensure that cyber is secure. But then when they need to ensure more working with the stakeholders for you to know how these laws are in place. For example, in the case of the African Convention, Grace can agree with me, and Moses also worked on it, Moses Karanja back there. The convention initially did not have human rights language, but then through consultations, it had to, and most of us here cannot, it had to go a lot of modifications. It was a very tiresome process, but then that's how democracies work. It's tiresome, it's push and pull, but then you need to ensure that the citizens are consulted through the whole process, right from the legislative, making process needs to be more transparent. So yeah, that's something I just wanted to highlight on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Makan. You want to say something?
Thank you very much, Mr. Moderator. Thank you, Ephraim. I just wanted to put emphasis on the question asked by one of the participants on affordability and access. Because I think that we shouldn't see affordability as free, but of course what we need to know is that access is guaranteed by to everybody. That is the most important issue, and then affordability also will make sure that your budget is not overstrained. Like Nena has said, she has put 5%, but during the African IGF, we had one participant who said he's paying $80 per month for 4 megabytes of bandwidth. So that means that is 90 or even 150% of the average African salary. I think access and affordability should translate into not blocking either through filtering, reducing bandwidth, because this happens to section of citizens for whatever reasons in Africa. And of course, prices should take into account the purchasing power of the ordinary citizen. When you know that most of Africans live with less than $1 per day. On the issue of making sure the declaration is used, and someone from Cameroon indicated that it should be a handbook to everyone. I believe when we had the African IGF meeting also, there was a lot of recommendations on this declaration. For example, it was indicated that companies, CEOs, and relevant technical entities are strongly urged to formally endorse the declaration, and that the African Commission on Human and People's Rights, which is in Gambia, headquartered there, should establish mechanisms to promote, monitor, and popularize the declaration through all sections of the African population. And we had the African Union representative during the concluding panel, where he indicated, I quote, "The declaration would be introduced to the relevant AU organs in the framework of the African Internet Governance Debate in order for the appropriate organs of the AU to adopt it. This will make the African continent a more cohesive, human, and dynamic environment." Thank you.
Thank you very much, Makan. We have four speakers left. Before I ask them to give their final remarks, I wanted to find out from the remote moderator if there are any further comments or questions. Yes? Okay, please, can you share them with us?
There we go. We have one more comment from Tom Orrell in the UK. You wanted to comment from non-African participant? And he's following up on David's point regarding the court system. And he wants to say that the use of existing human rights mechanism is crucial for the declaration, is crucial, and the declaration is filling a very important gap there, because African states, like all states, need to develop strong domestic protection for the right, and that is where the power to enforce those rights lies. In that sense, the declaration is a platform from which both the conversation between stakeholders and the advocacy on the rights can truly begin. And in that sense, the declaration is coming at an essential point in time. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. We have just about 8 minutes left. So I would have to give my remaining four speakers 2 minutes each to make their final comments. I'm sorry, we really have to try and wind this down. So, Benga, you go first.
Okay, just to speak to this being on the shelf, I think it's in the nature of governments to leave things on the shelf. In fact, the reason we call them government is because they pretend to work. Those of us that really want to work probably are not in government immediately. So I think it's in our responsibility to use this. They can leave it on the shelf, that's fine. But as you know, people who work in country, I think you have to turn this into a living document. A very simple example in Nigeria, we're working with the same National Assembly that wants to limit social media to pass a bill on digital rights and freedom. Wish us luck. But that's some action that has to happen on the ground. Regardless of where the document is, don't forget the letter is the one on the shelf. The spirit of the document is what should fuel your actions.
Thank you. Lillian.
Thank you, Edith. I think we need to be tactful in how to move forward with this document, especially the principles. So instead of, like I said, we don't want it to gain dust. And I think from the time it was launched last year to now, we've tried to achieve some baby steps. I think the web we want has taken that forward in giving small grants in how to promote the declaration. But I think as all of us who are here, we can tackle principle by principle. So if we're looking at, say, access, you know, there are those organizations that are, you know, just walking around, you know, promoting access to, you know, broadband or internet. There are those who are just in the area of freedom of expression, media expression. So let's just gang around moving principle by principle. Otherwise, if we take all the principles into just one document and, you know, trying to address them all at once, we may not achieve the full results that we seek to achieve.
Okay, important message. We need to be strategic in how we deploy the declaration. Don't swallow more than you can chew. You know what usually happens when you do that. Abila.
Thank you, Edith. I think we need to dispel the misconception that this declaration is only for governments. It's for all of us, Africans and non-Africans. So we need to engage with the declaration. Please visit the website, look at the principles, see how you can, there's also an action plan inside, you know, the whole declaration, how you can engage with it. And I also think that this document is just not a declaration, but it needs to inform our policy within our countries. And also, we can use it as an example of how multi-stakeholder works, because how multi-stakeholder processes works, because we did this whole initiative as different stakeholders, and you can use it at a national level to actually show how multi-stakeholder processes work in action. And I also, one conclusion that I would put across is that we, when I was talking about access, is that I think we also need to look at the barriers for access beyond the technical ones and put the people, us, all of us, at the center to be able to defeat all the challenges that we face. Thank you.
Thank you, Amila. So, David, you have the final word.
So, actually, these last two sets of points, I think, are really important. The one of sort of being strategic and incremental. I think it's true. You don't want to dilute any of the particular principles, and you know some of them will be really valuable in some circumstances, and others won't. So I think that's a really important comment. And the other comment about informing government policy, I think, is also really important to find ways to inject into either legislative discussions or others, the principles here. The last thing I wanted to say was something that that I should have said before, which is, so the government of Nigeria has invited me on an official visit, which hopefully I'll be able to do in the spring. And that might be, and also coming from the question, I guess it was coming online, about finding ways for UN mechanisms to use it. I mean, hopefully that visit will get scheduled. Hopefully it will be this spring, and it might be a nice opportunity for us to give a platform to it that would be both domestic, regional, and to an extent international, because not only, you know, would I visit, but then I report on the visit afterwards to the Human Rights Council, and that might be an opportunity to highlight the principles themselves. Thank you.
Mr. Chair.
Thank you, David. That's very good news.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
Can Web We Want sponsor David's trip to Nigeria?
And I will accompany David to Nigeria. Yes, I'm sure we can work out those details. details later on, but it's something that we should certainly engage fully and make sure it happens and get the visibility that I think it requires. We have a couple of minutes, and McCann wants to make a final recommendation, so I'll just give him a second.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. It's just in line with the panel recommendations in Addis during African IGF after we discussed this declaration. There was a recommendation on adopting an African Internet Rights Day. And I believe we should pursue it in this in the coming part of the process, and we will push also at the African Union level so that this can be taken into account. So I think from now on we should be having it as a recommendation through the process. Thank you.
Okay, thank you for that. Just to leave you with some good news, especially members of the Access to Information community. UNESCO's General Assembly, General Conference has today passed the resolution designating September 28th of every year as Universal Access to Information Day. It's a battle we've been on for the past 13 years since Access to Information Day. Since it was recommended in Bulgaria in 2002, it's finally become an official day. So I think that that's some good news that we can take away from here. And I think all of us working on internet rights and freedoms are also interested in the free flow of information. So that's, and I think UNESCO was deliberate in calling it Universal Access to Information Day to encompass the whole range of information flows that that should be captured under that. So I want to thank the participants first for coming to this session, for their engagement, for their attention, and for making it happen. When you have a forum like this, you always worry whether you have anybody to talk to, because it would have been disastrous if we had gathered there and we didn't have participants to talk to. So we would massage our egos and then walk quietly out of the room. So thank you very much for making it meaningful for us, for raising some of the important issues that have also come up. And then I want to thank the speakers for your willingness to share your time, share your energy, share your experiences and expertise on these issues. It's very much appreciated. Obviously, this is a conversation that's going to continue. We don't want this to gather dust, analog or digital. So we are going to be thinking of creative ways to engage with it in a continuous process. So thank you very much, and I hope we'll continue to talk about this going forward. And for those of you who would be available in the spring, please come to Nigeria and join me in welcoming David so that he would have, I can promise him some pepper soup in addition to all the intellectual exercises that would also be happening. So thank you very much, and I hope you found it worthwhile.